Buenas tardes y bienvenidos al Museo de las Ciencias. Mi nombre es Vicente Pelejero y pertenezco al Departamento de Divulgación de la Ciudad de Les Arts y les Ciències. Y en primer lugar me gustaría agradecer la presencia de don Javier Quesada, presidente de la Fundación Jaume I, y me gustaría presentar a los compañeros que me acompañan en la mesa, Juan José Hernández, director del Instituto de Física Corpuscular, y don Jordi Vidal, decano de la Facultad de Física. Hoy, bueno, y por supuesto, al profesor Gerard Toft. Hoy celebramos el 18º aniversario del museo, hace 18 años que abrimos las puertas, y qué mejor forma de hacerlo que, pues, por todo lo grande, ¿no? Con un premio Nobel, y es una ocasión muy especial para todos nosotros. Y de hecho, pues bueno, muestra de ello es la gran expectación que ha creado, y bueno, para nosotros es impresionante, pues, tener la sala llena. Me gustaría empezar mi breve intervención destacando la importancia que tienen las alianzas en este mundo globalizado, y de estas alianzas esta tarde es un reflejo de lo que se puede conseguir cuando dos instituciones, el Instituto de Física Corpuscular y la Ciutat de les Arts i les Ciències, aunan esfuerzos, ¿no? Para poder conseguir, pues, que la divulgación realmente sea una divulgación de excelencia. Y gracias a esta colaboración, a principio de julio tuvimos la oportunidad de ofrecer la conferencia del doctor Baris, Premio Nobel de Física de 2017, y hace apenas un mes tuvimos el honor de contar con la presencia del doctor Kajita, Premio Nobel de Física 2015. Y la verdad es que esto no es casual, esto se debe a la ciencia que se está haciendo en las universidades, en los institutos de la Comunidad Valenciana, investigación de excelencia, que, bueno, que hace que al final, pues, podemos contar con todas estas personas que están visitando también la ciudad y aprovechar esas visitas científicas también para dar a conocer, para divulgar la ciencia a la ciudadanía. Este fin de semana comentaba José Pío Beltrán, coordinador institucional de la Delegación Valenciana del CSIC, que el año pasado nuestras instituciones, las de la Comunidad Valenciana, publicaron más de 110 artículos científicos en revistas de reconocido prestigio, lo que podríamos decir revistas de gran impacto científico. Y eso apunta a una media de un artículo cada 3 días. Yo creo que la producción científica que estamos teniendo en la Comunidad Valenciana es importante, y también es importante que la ciudadanía sea consciente de todo ese trabajo, de toda esa investigación que se está realizando. Y para finalizar, me gustaría realizar una reflexión, ¿no? ¿Por qué todo este esfuerzo y todo este empeño en poner al alcance de la ciudadanía a estos expertos de primer nivel, ¿no? Estamos hablando de 3 premios Nobel. La semana pasada nos visitó la doctora Francesca Figueras, presidenta de la Sociedad Española de Astronomía y experta en la misión Gaia. Y el motivo no es ni más ni menos que necesitamos que la sociedad se interese por la ciencia. Y también necesitamos despertar las vocaciones entre los más jóvenes, que tengan referentes, que tengan modelos de éxito con los que identificarse, porque una sociedad sin ciencia es una sociedad sin futuro. Bueno, simplemente estas palabras para darles la bienvenida, para agradecerles que estén ustedes aquí con nosotros compartiendo, pues, esta fiesta de la ciencia, y simplemente cedo la palabra a Jordi Vidal, decano de la Facultad de Física. Gracias.
Muy bien, muchas gracias. Muy bien, pues muchas gracias. Pues quería simplemente agradecer la invitación por parte de la Ciudad de las Artes y las Ciencias a esta conferencia. Y pues para mí es un honor realmente estar en esta mesa y en esta conferencia con el profesor Toft, con Juanjo, el director de nuestro instituto, y con Vicente aquí hoy. Déjeme que les cuente un poco, porque en mi doble condición de decano de la Facultad de Física y miembro del IFIC, pues les puedo contar, aunque casi todos ustedes seguro que lo conocen. El IFIC saben que es un instituto mixto del Consejo Superior de Investigaciones Científicas y de la Universidad de Valencia, y que su plantilla, al menos en lo que se refiere a la plantilla de investigación, pues está formada prácticamente al 50% entre profesorado de la universidad y miembros que son del Consejo Superior de Investigaciones Científicas. Esa fórmula, como ya seguramente ustedes ya me habrán oído que he dicho, es una fórmula que realmente nos está produciendo una enorme satisfacción, porque pensamos que estamos haciendo muy buen trabajo, porque los investigadores que luego van a trabajar en el IFIC, la formación de esos investigadores, pues tienen un bebedero en la Facultad de Física de donde poder coger el capital humano, que es de lo más importante. Déjenme que les cuente ahora un poco cuál es la situación de la facultad, y para eso pues me refiero a una de las cosas que últimamente están muy de moda, que son los rankings. En los rankings, yo no creo mucho en los rankings, pero pues, esto es una cosa que en fin, todo el mundo trata. En el último ranking que ha aparecido publicado, en el Best Global Universities Ranking, resulta que la Universidad de Valencia está en el quinto lugar de las españolas, no del mundo, y la Facultad de Física pues, está en el tercer lugar de las españolas, por detrás de la Autónoma de Madrid y de la Autónoma de Barcelona. Realmente, yo creo que ahí es un lugar importante, es un lugar que creo que nos merecemos en ese ranking. Y si lo comparamos, digamos, con el ranking mundial, pues la Facultad de Física de la Universidad de Valencia estaría en el 135. Probablemente, pues también, digamos el peso de la falta de tradición en este país, de la falta de inversión, y no nos podemos comparar con universidades, pues, digamos, mucho más prestigiosas y con mucha más tradición. Estos parámetros de los rankings son siempre muy, 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 muy volubles y que uno esté en el punto 40, en el puesto 45 o esté en el punto 150, pues depende, como dice un compañero mío, depende de los datos y cómo se manejen los datos. Como ustedes saben, si a los datos se les interroga con astucia y con eficacia, los datos confiesan cualquier cosa que uno desee. Esto es una cosa que se sabe desde siempre. En cuanto a la calidad, digamos, de los estudios que nosotros hacemos en nuestra facultad, les quería decir simplemente que el camino, digamos, en cuanto a la posición, bueno, el Instituto, el IFIC, se me olvidaba, claro, estaba pensando ahora en el IFIC, por supuesto, es un instituto de prestigio no solo nacional, sino internacional. Es uno de los mejores institutos, me atrevería a decir, uno de los mejores institutos de España, sino el mejor, y tiene una calidad indiscutible a nivel europeo y a nivel mundial. E incluso en algunos rankings figuran el tercer lugar detrás del CERI y del Fermilab. Pero bueno, en fin, esta es otra historia. Lo que les quiero decir simplemente es que en cuestión de rankings, los rankings no son la última palabra en estas cosas, pero sí que indican un poco la posición en la que uno está en el mundo de la investigación y en el mundo de la docencia y en el mundo de la universidad. Y creo que estamos en una buena situación, la Facultad de Física de la Universidad de Valencia. Lo que nosotros hacemos es, creo que de lo que estamos orgullosos de hacer es de coger un material humano muy bueno, porque nuestros estudiantes vienen con muy buen nivel. Tenemos los estudiantes con nota de corte en selectividad, con la nota de corte más alta de España, y a esos estudiantes les damos una muy buena formación. Y esa buena formación luego revierte en que esos estudiantes van a institutos de investigación a acabar su formación en másters, realizan tesis, y luego los que quieren dedicarse pues, a la investigación y ya han empezado una tesis, pues siguen en el mundo de la investigación. ¿Y cuál es nuestra esperanza? Pues nuestra esperanza es que alguno de esos estudiantes que formamos, pues que tenga esa iluminación para resolver un problema de esos que decimos importantes, de esos problemas fundamentales de la física. Y como dijo Pablo Picasso, cuando le llegue la inspiración, esperemos que esté trabajando. Muy bien, pues muchas gracias.
Buenas tardes, bienvenidos. Es un verdadero placer recibir al profesor Tooft. Normalmente, cuando tenemos un galardonado con el premio Nobel, yo suelo hacer un resumen de las investigaciones por las que le fue concedido. En este caso es complicado y he estado a punto de renunciar porque las investigaciones del profesor Tooft son realmente muy especializadas. Sin embargo, yo no sé si por audacia o por insensatez, voy a intentar resumirles las razones por las que le fue concedido el premio Nobel al profesor Tooft. En la segunda mitad de los años 20, los físicos empiezan a tener éxito en unir las dos teorías que habían revolucionado la física, la relatividad especial de Einstein y la mecánica cuántica. En particular, Paul Dirac descubre una ecuación que describe cómo se comporta el electrón. Es la primera clara ecuación donde mecánica cuántica y relatividad se unen. Y esta ecuación tiene unos éxitos indiscutibles. Da cabida a la antimateria, que es descubierta pocos años después. Explica de manera natural la rotación de las partículas, el llamado spin. Explica el desdoblamiento de niveles energéticos en los átomos. Un verdadero éxito. Esa continuación de la unión de las dos teorías da lugar a que la teoría del electromagnetismo, que había sido formulada el siglo anterior, empieza a ser descrita con una teoría cuántica relativista. Es lo que se llama la electrodinámica cuántica. Sus ecuaciones, sin embargo, son muy difíciles de resolver, salvo en los casos más sencillos. Entonces, los físicos emplean un método que había tenido éxito con la mecánica cuántica y con otras aplicaciones. Es el método de perturbaciones, que es básicamente hacer aproximaciones sucesivas a la solución del problema. Y eso, como digo, había tenido éxito anteriormente. Sin embargo, con la electrodinámica cuántica, el fracaso es total. Una vez que uno pasa de la primera aproximación, la teoría responde a todo infinito. La teoría diverge. Y es un problema que básicamente se necesita una década para resolver. Es a mediados de los años 40, en la segunda mitad, cuando varios físicos, Schwinger, Feynman, Tomonaga, descubren que hay una manera de redefinir las constantes de la teoría para hacer desaparecer los infinitos. A ese proceso se le llama renormalización y tiene un éxito increíble con la electrodinámica cuántica. La electrodinámica cuántica es capaz, ahora, actualmente, de predecir el momento magnético del muón, que es un hermano más pesado del electrón, con una precisión de una parte en mil millones, algo completamente desconocido en las teorías ya no físicas de cualquier tipo. De modo que se convierte en una teoría muy sólida, muy asentada, y en los años 50, en la siguiente década, dos físicos, Young y Mills, descubren que unas simetrías que tiene la electrodinámica cuántica se pueden hacer a más generales. Una simetría para los físicos es, por ejemplo, que este salón esté orientado este-oeste o norte-sur, nos da absolutamente lo mismo, al menos durante la noche. Durante el día es probable que el sol... Eso ocurre también en el mundo de las partículas. En una especie de espacios internos podemos rotarlas sin que nada cambie en absoluto. Young y Mills descubren que esas rotaciones se pueden hacer en más dimensiones, por decirlo así. ¿Y por qué es eso importante? Porque esas teorías que ellos crean se parecen mucho a cómo es la interacción débil, la que está produciendo la desintegración natural de lo que nos rodea. O, años después, se descubre que también puede describir la interacción fuerte, la que hace que la materia sea estable y los núcleos no se destruyan. El problema de esa teoría es que no admite la existencia de la masa. Es completamente incompatible con la masa y, en cierta medida, es olvidada esa teoría porque el mundo que conocemos está rodeado de partículas masivas. En torno a los años 60, una serie de físicos descubren que hay una manera muy sutil de introducir la masa en las teorías sin romper las cosas, sin entrar como un elefante en una cacharrería, sino de alguna manera de forma suave. Es lo que se llama rotura espontánea de simetría y que da lugar al mecanismo de Higgs, que a su vez predice una partícula, el bosón de Higgs, que se tardaría 40 años en descubrir. El bosón de Higgs fue descubierto en el Laboratorio Europeo de Física de Partículas en 2012, en un verdadero esfuerzo tecnológico y experimental. A finales de los años 60, varios físicos se dan cuenta que todos esos componentes, asimetrías ampliadas, formas suaves de introducir la masa, pueden combinarse para juntar en una sola teoría la interacción débil y la interacción electromagnética, hacer una teoría unificada. Por aquel entonces todo esto no era la línea principal de la física teórica en absoluto, era, bueno, un modelo más. De hecho, el modelo del año 67 del profesor Weinberg de esa teoría unificada pasa desapercibido, realmente sin mucho impacto. Por esa misma época, un estudiante de doctorado llamado Gerhard Etthoft empieza a estudiar las propiedades de, esas teorías. ¿Son renormalizables? ¿Se puede hacer lo mismo que con la electrodinámica cuántica? ¿Redefinir las cosas para hacer desaparecer los infinitos? 4 años después aparecen 2 artículos que pasan a la historia de la física en las que Gerhard Etthoft demuestra que tanto en el caso de las teorías de simetría ampliada sin masa como las teorías con masa es posible hacer ese proceso de renormalización, de hacer desaparecer los infinitos. Y entonces se crea un boom, porque esa demostración de la renormalizabilidad de la teoría, de que se pueden hacer los infinitos, ya hace sospechar a los físicos de que hay algo realmente serio en esas teorías unificadas. Esa es la razón por la que, de alguna manera, el Comité Nobel le otorga el premio Nobel a él y a su supervisor de tesis, Martin Fellman, por la demostración y por la carta de naturaleza de que las teorías unificadas son algo serio que considerar. Y de hecho estamos viéndolo ahora, como esas teorías ya predicen con precisiones del 1% y más allá los fenómenos físicos. Las contribuciones del profesor Etthoft van en muchas más partes de la física de partículas, ha contribuido de manera muy notable en todas ellas, y creo que no es de eso de lo que nos va a hablar hoy, es de un problema que lleva mucho tiempo en la cabeza de los físicos. Desde la formulación de la mecánica cuántica, siempre los físicos se han preguntado, ¿realmente los resultados que esta teoría nos da son solo estadísticos? ¿No habrá algo que desconocemos por debajo de ella que de alguna manera todavía está por descubrir? Y aquí acabo, por supuesto, porque no espero no pisarle la charla al profesor. Gracias.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here and making this a full room, and I'm very proud of attracting so many people in to listen to what I'm going to talk about, which is basically the subject that is very close to my heart today. And what we really want to do is we really want to understand why the world functions the way it does. So why are the various interactions among particles the way they are? Why do we have atoms and molecules and subatomic particles? How do they interact and how can we understand the way they interact? And during our investigations, we came across a few very strange features of our present understanding. And one of these features has to do with the notion of free will, and this is really something very basic. So I would like to share with you what we found and why it is so important to understand exactly how to react upon with these findings. How do they fit in our overall view of not only the physical world, but the entire world? How do things function? And let me go back a long way, actually, to the story of my life, which is just only a few sentences now. I was born shortly after the Second World War in a small town in the Netherlands called Den Helder. You see this in this little circle. But I grew up most of the time of my life in The Hague, the town where the Dutch government is. And I studied in a town named Utrecht, more or less in the center of gravity of the Netherlands. And that's where I stayed most of my time doing physics. The reason why I went to Utrecht was that my uncle, who was a well-known Dutch theoretical physics professor, was teaching in Utrecht. And whenever I met my uncle, I would bombard him with questions. And very often his question was, when I was a little kid, wait until you can go to a university, come to my university, listen to my lectures, and then you will get the complete answers to your questions. So that's exactly what I did. And in Utrecht at that time, theoretical physics was still in town. In most European towns, the science faculties originated in the town itself, in the university buildings, but then they moved out to the perimeter of the town in modern-looking buildings, more or less like what we have here. And that also happened in Holland. So this was the last time that physics was being done at one of the canals in Utrecht. By that time, we had three buildings occupied along this canal, and there we were following lectures and had lots of discussions about theoretical physics. And everything was at walking distance, or you can jump on your bicycle and go through all of the town, which was a very special way of learning science. And I was mixed with the elderly staff members all the time. I was still a young student, but all the staff members had lots of discussions, and I loved enjoying them. So yes, when I was a student, I learned about space, time, and matter, and I learned how all these particles in space and time are interacting with each other and how all this is controlled by equations. And the first thing one learned was how electrons move in an atom. And the science that you needed to use there was called quantum mechanics. When, as a student, you first learn about quantum mechanics, it looks like a theory that applies to electrons in an atom. And the great guru in that subject was Niels Bohr, a Danish physicist who had figured out how to describe an atom using this new technique. In fact, my uncle had been a postdoc in Copenhagen for a short time, and he learned Niels Bohr's views about this new theory. But then I got a shock. And the shock was to discover that in the world of the little things, atoms, electrons, nuclei, and other particles, everything had to be controlled by quantum mechanics. Not only the electrons going around an atom, but everything else as well. As soon as something is small and light, then you can no longer explain its behavior in the way we explain how stars and planets move, how an automobile drives, and so on. No, you have to use a new way of thinking, and that new way of thinking was called quantum mechanics. So what is quantum mechanics? Usually, this theory is explained to students, well, you have to explain one thing at a time because it's complicated and you need some adjustment. You need to rethink everything you thought you know about this world to understand how quantum mechanics works. And one of the things people tell you is that we are no longer working with numbers, but with more complicated things that describe where a particle is, how fast is it going, and so on. We use matrices instead of numbers. A matrix is a sequence of numbers, both in rows and in columns, a square array of numbers. And we need those arrays of numbers to describe what's really going on. And as a student, you ask yourself, yeah, but what does that mean? This particle sits here or there. Can I not use numbers to describe that? They say, yeah, but if you only use ordinary numbers, you don't get it quite right. It's something more complicated. But what I later found out, and you read more and more about it, and also you think more and more about this theory, what quantum mechanics really is about is not this strange way of working with numbers, but rather the fact that the numbers that you thought to be continuous numbers, like the position of the particle can be anywhere and anywhere in between, you can indicate where a particle sits very accurately, but instead the numbers tend to get quantized. And quantized means that you have only integer parts. You can say the particle's here, there, or there, but you can't say so very well that it sits in between two points. That holds not only for the, well, actually doesn't hold literally for the position, in a rather vague sense, this holds for the position of a particle. It also holds for its velocity, its energy, and other features. In fact, everything that we normally think to be continuous, here you see at the left, a continuous figure, but that's how you think about an object classically. This could be an automobile or a planet or whatever. But when you break it up and you look at the smallest possible units out of which it's made, these units are quantized. They are separate blocks with a definite amount of energy, of momentum, of force, and so on. Everything is now distinguished into quanta. The fact that matter is divided into quanta was already understood before the 20th century, although not yet agreed about upon by everybody, but it was basically understood that there should be a smallest amount of matter. We call that a molecule. A molecule is the smallest amount of matter that has the same chemical properties as the matter at large. But then you might say, yes, but I thought a molecule can be broken up into atoms. Yes, it can be broken up, but those atoms have different properties. Even an atom can be broken up into smaller subatomic particles, but their properties are, again, very different from the properties of the atom itself. Now, what happened in the complete course of the 20th century was that lots of things were discovered to be quantized, and this quantum theory was going to dominate over our way of thinking about particles. So the first thing that happened was light. Light was understood already for some centuries that it is an electromagnetic phenomenon. Light is a wave-like structure that propagates with a fixed velocity, the velocity of light. It propagates from throughout the entire universe, basically. And this propagation is like a wave. And of course, waves are described by continuous numbers. A wave is a continuous variation of a field as a function of time. But even so, the first remarkable discovery was in the 20th century, actually in 1900. The discovery was these waves are broken up into energy packets. This was the discovery of Max Planck in 1900. And at first, it looked like some peculiarity of light. Planck didn't think of light itself to be broken up into packages, but he postulated that light can only be emitted in fixed amount of energy from one substance to another substance. And those energy packets were then later called quanta. It is actually Einstein who later said, no, we have to be more radical about this. Light itself is quanta. Well, okay, you can still live with that situation. It was a new, very crazy thing. But Planck very convincingly explained to the physicist communities that you had to think of light this way. If you'd ignore this, you would get things that are totally different from the physical world as we know it. So, for instance, the amount of light emitted by an object that is heated to a certain temperature will be unbounded. It will be infinite. And that is certainly not right. If you heat up a light bulb, you can heat it up to a certain temperature, and depending on the temperature, it will emit more or less light. But the amount of light emitted by a light bulb is never infinite. That would be meaningless. That would be not well defined. This is the first time that infinities showed up. This was talked about previously in the introduction. Infinities showed up in the physical theories, but this infinity was then cured by Max Planck. Quantum mechanics removes infinities out of light. So, as I said before, also molecules can be considered of quanta of matter, but the most remarkable thing is that continuous objects tend to become discrete. And what I now want to convey to you is that that is a more basic feature of quantum theory than the strange idea that we have to work with matrices rather than with numbers. And I'll tell you in a moment why that seems to be so. Now, not only positions of particles and energy of particles is divided into units, into packets, into quanta, but also rotation. Now, this might confuse you, and I want to bring home the message that quantum mechanics is a very confusing theory. Large objects can rotate in any possible way. So here you see a large object rotating, and it can rotate smoothly to any angles. But when it comes to quantum particles, very, very tiny particles, they cannot point in any direction you like. They can only have discrete rotations, as you see here in what I illustrate here, that this L shape is a simplified model of a very tiny particle, and it can only be in distinct positions. Now you ask, how can that be? Because I never knew that atoms have a preferred direction. No, you didn't know, because in fact, which are exactly the principal directions are in which things are rotating is not well understood. And there are some mysteries on this whole topic. So here already, the fact that angles are also quantized generates mysteries. Things we don't understand. And still now today, we don't quite understand why it is that rotations are discretized. What does it mean? Well, it's a very special feature of our modern way of dealing with particles that explains this. But what it explains foremost is we understand how to do the calculations. In particular, when things rotate, we have to replace the angles by matrices. And then we understand exactly how all this works in practice. But the question still stays there, remains, what does this really mean about this particle? What is the actual orientation of a particle? So here, quantum mechanics starts to be mysterious. Don't worry if you don't quite understand what I'm saying here, because this topic is really complicated and only not understood and disputed a lot by experts. So don't expect even that you ought to understand exactly what is going on here. In the case of energy, you can think of a particle moving in a landscape with hills and valleys, and the particle can only oscillate around in here, or if the particle has more energy, it can go all the way from here to here. But the energy then turns out to be quantized. So now we have energy levels, fixed amount of energy that a particle is allowed to have if it sits in a tiny bottle out of which it cannot escape. Then the energy of the particles become discrete. That happens in an atom, for instance. Atoms can be only in very distinct, discretized spaces. Very surprising and, again, difficult to quite understand how this goes. Now, you might have thought that, okay, if you say that all these continuous numbers are replaced by integers, which you can count, that should make our life easier. Because now you can count how many states there are, you can count the most possible positions of a particle, and also you can count the possible ways the angles can go. So shouldn't working with such numbers be easier? In principle, yes. And the belief is that once you understand this completely, we will know how to write down very simple equations. But we don't understand exactly how it goes. And that makes the topic that you work with extremely difficult to understand. We don't understand why everything in this world is quantized. Now, nature found a beautiful way how to handle quantized numbers, even if they don't match, because that's going to be the question now. Suppose that the quanta don't fit well onto each other. If different particles have different energy quanta, how can they interact? Now things get pretty serious. Now you have to try to understand how to describe this right. What we do understand is how to write down the equations, and this topic is called quantum mechanics. The word quantum, of course, says it all. It says everything is discretized. It's a law that replaces the mechanics of continuous objects. That's why we call it mechanics. So this is what quantum mechanics is. Now let me try to explain to you a little bit what the peculiar situation is that physicists encountered when trying to work with quantized particles, atoms, molecules, or waves, or anything else that is small, tiny, and light. So it turns out that the situation gets quite a bit more difficult than you might have expected to fill the gaps between the quanta. Now, when I gave this lecture in this way first, I was in China. So I used the Chinese currency as an example. And I decided to keep it that way, just to not to change my lecture all the time, but also because it gives you some feeling of weirdness of the situation. So we have in our pockets a currency that's called Yuan. And now you can ask the question, how much something costs in Yuans. However, you do not have any smaller part of a Yuan. You don't have Yuan cents. You only have integer Yuan, like a euro, but you don't have euro cents or whatever other units you might think of. You might want to break the unit into smaller subunits. Now, suppose that if you buy 4 eggs, that they cost together 3 yuan and 32 yuan cents. Well, that's the price that economists have agreed about for the price for eggs. You want to buy 4 eggs. You have to pay 3.32 yuans. Now, how do we do that if I'm not allowed to break a yuan into pieces? So you might think, okay, I take a saw and I break Yuan into pieces, and then I can pay the exact amount. But then people say, no, that thing is not valid here. This is not a valid coin. You are not allowed to use this. So how do we do it right? So how do the quantized eggs agree with the quantized Yuans? And we haven't found a proper answer to this. But we have found the equations for a proper answer. And that's very remarkable. So the equations tell you, you have to do something that we call wave functions. So like light, the energy wave packets of light describe this wavy structure of light itself. So we use waves. Now this sounds very mysterious. Let me try to explain what it is. A wave is, for me, synonymous with something that is vague, that's wavy, not very sharply defined. So we have something that's not yet sharply defined. So how many yuans do I pay for 4 eggs? Well, it is a wave that says sometimes you pay 1 yuan, sometimes 2, sometimes 3, sometimes 4, sometimes 5. But the further the total amount deviates from the actual price of the 4 eggs, the hazier it becomes. So you have a wave that is about right. This, on the average, about 3 of these are sharp. The 4th one is quite less sharp. The fifth one is very hazy. And this is how you pay, but you never break a yuan into pieces. You just say it's less probable. This one is very probable. This one is very probable. This is reasonably probable, somewhat improbable, very improbable, and so on. So we introduce a notion of probability in our equations. Then we say, this is how we handle this. You see, the nice thing about the situation is that you go many times to the market to buy eggs, and you pay always this way. On the average, you pay exactly 3.31 yuans for 4 eggs. So on the average, it works out fine, but every time you have these strange fluctuations. Sometimes you pay a little bit too much, sometimes you pay too little, but on the average, it comes out to the right amount. This is roughly what we do in quantum physics for particles. When we describe particles, we make a description that works out correctly if we do statistics, if you do very many exchanges at the same time, we repeat the experiment very many times, then statistically the correct answer comes out. But every single experiment gives something that doesn't make any sense. This is how it works, and for this we need matrices. I won't bore you with the details of that. If you go to the university, you follow lectures of quantum mechanics, you will learn how to work with matrices. I'm not going to explain that here. So, how does this work? This does work with elementary particles. And so now it's clear that quantum mechanics comes with an amount of vagueness. But unlike the world of eggs and quants, we have very sophisticated mathematics for this. We use what we call superpositions. This thing here is a superposition of one yuan and no yuans. Because it's a superposition, the average is some grayish color in between. And for particles, this attitude, if you keep doing it all the time, works perfectly. Now you no longer have certainties about where a particle sits, because a particle can be sit here, it's a little bit gray, it can also be sitting there, it's not sure, it sits somewhere in between. That's a wave of particles, and that's how our equations are to be interpreted. And if you are a good scientist, you would react upon this saying, that's very unsatisfactory. We don't understand that interpretation at all. Some physicists have become so used to working with these equations that they say, we know exactly how to interpret this. Don't worry, it all comes out fine. But the main answer is, yes, it comes out fine. If you say you have to use these equations, your calculations always come out correct. But very often, the equations will not say where a particle is sitting, it will say where it probably will be sitting, or what its distribution is, or if you do the experiment with 1,000,000 particles, then it tells you exactly how many particles will go this way, how many particles go that way, how many particles go that way. That's what the theory is very good at, but to describe an individual particle remains hazy and, to my mind, very unsatisfactory. For instance, suppose that we don't stop at eggs, but we also work with oranges and apples. We have big eggs, we have small eggs. Suppose you want to cut an apple in half. Suppose that that is possible just for halves. I wouldn't like to do it for an egg, because how do you buy half an egg in a market? That's harder. But you can understand that if all these things now interact, you want to exchange apples for eggs, or for oranges, or for sugar, where the grains are very small. How would you do all this, and how would you write down the correct equations for this way of doing your administration of how particles behave? So, yuans were in a wave function, now the eggs were in a wave function, but now let's turn things upside down. Now let's say I have 3 yuans, how many eggs can I buy? And again, you can't break up an egg, you can't buy half an egg. So again, for the eggs, you have the same thing. You can certainly buy 1 egg, you can probably buy 2 eggs. Whether you can buy 3 eggs becomes a little bit more uncertain. The fourth is very uncertain. The fifth and the sixth, they become very hazy. But they are never broken eggs, right? You can say you have this quantum or you don't have this quantum. It's never broken. So, but now comes an interesting question. Do you how if you always use once with a fixed amount and you buy a vague number of eggs, or you have a fixed number of eggs, but you want to use a vague number of ones, how can you go from one picture into the other picture? And that's now what quantum mechanics really gets a mathematically interesting theory. I go from the one picture to the egg picture. And it's not the same, but you have to translate one transaction into another transaction, where sometimes the number of ones is vague, sometimes the number of eggs is vague. Now, when it comes to elementary particles, my claim is that particles are always vague. They're all vague. There's vagueness all around. But still, we can apply this mathematics and we can still get our way around it. If you become famous, get Nobel Prizes for what you do with this vague theory, it all works. It works fantastically well. But still, you might agree with me that there's something strange and perhaps unsatisfactory about this situation. So one question you can ask is, suppose I have a wave that's okay when you do a calculation, but what is it that is really going on? When you did your shopping, you know, what is it that you have in your wallet? A broken yuan? No. What is it that you have in your bag of eggs? A broken egg? No, it's not that. It's something more curious, something totally different. And the government of the country will insist that the only valid currency is an integer yuan. You're not allowed to break it. So the question now is, how do you do this correct? So an atom, for instance, cannot be broken into smaller atoms. What you can do is take the atom apart, but then you get totally different particles out of it, an atom is built. But this quantization rule is very strict. Now, the energy of a photon is quantized, but in a way that depends on the frequency of the photon. Vastly oscillating light, that's ultraviolet light, will have higher and bigger energy quanta than infrared light. So suppose that you have a substance that absorbs ultraviolet light and turns it to infrared light, then how does it handle the quanta? That's then the question. And you can ask, what is it that's really happening in this substance? When it converts high energy light into low energy light, it converts yuans into eggs. Some materials manage to do that. And the question is, how does that all work? In fact, the first discovery of quantum mechanics is exactly with light, with photons, where the total energy in the quanta can be variable depending on the frequency of the light. Now, just a side issue to tell you where all this is going, because what it's doing is that now when an electron has an orbit around an atom, then that orbit may have different energies at different spots. So the orbit, the equations for the orbit becomes very complex. And the electron will be more often here and more often there around the atom, but never at that side of the atom. So the location of the electron around the atom becomes very complicated now. But this is actually something that tells us something about the atom itself. Just because the electrons around atoms behave in this crazy way, it means that atoms, when you put many atoms together, they like to sit in very special arrangements. They want their electrons to be distributed in as favorable as possible position so that the total energy is minimal. I talk about energy again. I thought energy was quantized. Yes, but okay, this is the rule you have to apply. But now you find that, for instance, this is a molecule of alcohol. This is a molecule of water. And the strange thing about water is, the water molecule, most of you know this, it is one oxygen atom, the red thing here in the middle, and two hydrogen atoms which sit glued upon the oxygen. This glue is caused by the electrons that move around the oxygen atom. But these electrons have some places where they like to sit and some places where they don't like to sit. So these electrons like to sit at an angle of about 105 degrees. That happens to be close to the angle that the two of the four points of a tetrahedron are located. And now you can suspect that maybe this crazy law of quantum mechanics for these electrons, like the electrons to form a tetrahedron and to prefer to sit at the points of a tetrahedron. Well, there are two hydrogens connecting to one oxygen, so two points of the tetrahedron are occupied by a hydrogen atom, and the two others are empty. But it means that they're not sitting opposite to each other, but at this strange angle of about 110 degrees, or 105, something like that. And so this explains why water has properties as complicated as it has. Water is a very strange chemical substance, and one of the strangest things is due to the fact that these molecules are at an angle. These atoms are at an angle with respect to each other. So you may understand then that quantum mechanics is something very important to understand. It explains some of the properties of water, not only water, of in fact all chemical substances. We now understand how quantum mechanics causes atoms to be bound in very special ways around each other. So all of chemistry eventually can be reduced to physical properties of atoms, and these physical properties are a consequence of quantum mechanics. So for instance, when you take grains of sugar, this is the grains of sugar in a microscope. If you blow it up further, eventually you get the sugar molecule, and again, the sugar molecule has very special arrangements of the various kinds of atoms. There are C atoms, carbon, there are O atoms, oxygen, and there are H atoms, hydrogen, which are all glued together, but all in a very special arrangement. This gives sugar the typical property of a sugar molecule. If all molecules were just hanging together in an arbitrary way, there wouldn't be life. So, in fact, the property of living structures is eventually to be reduced to peculiar features of quantum mechanics. This just shows how central quantum mechanics is in the world of physics. Again, our difficulty is, yes, we describe these atoms this way, but where are these atoms now exactly? What is real about them, and why are they so vague? Essentially, when I draw this picture, you saw that these atoms are a little bit vague. They are not precisely defined. We don't know exactly where they are sitting, but on the average, they sit in this configuration. So now our difficulty is, and every now and then someone asks this question, what does reality mean? What is it that's really happening in this atom that gives it this very strange behavior? Now, in the 20th century, about 100 years ago, people were asking exactly this question. How does quantum mechanics work? The theory had just been discovered. In around 1926, Erwin Schrödinger came with the right equations for quantum mechanics. And Einstein was one of the first to object. He said, yeah, that's fine, you have these equations, but what does the equation mean? And I believe it's all wrong. Now, Einstein had not discovered it himself, so it had to be wrong. But it's not that easy. And he was fighting against Niels Bohr and Schrödinger, who understood the equations, and Niels Bohr understood the interpretation. But Schrödinger, although he was at the very base of the discovery of quantum mechanics, he sided more with Einstein than with Niels Bohr. So there were these endless discussions going on, in particular in the town of Copenhagen in Denmark, where these physicists came together and they started yelling at each other about what quantum mechanics means. And actually, my belief is that we are only at the beginning of all this. And the human mind is not yet quite good enough to come with a natural answer to all these questions. My explanation for this is that we are only a couple of 100,000 years away from the primates. What does a monkey understand about quantum mechanics? Nothing, of course, but we are only 100,000 years away from that. The universe is billions of years old, and we have billions of years to become much smarter than what we are now, and certainly is much smarter than those monkeys. So we'll figure this out, but it might cost time. So, in fact, it was before quantum mechanics that people even didn't realize that there are such things as quantum superpositions. Because an atom can be here, an atom can be there, but it can also be both here and there. We call that a superposition of states. And in fact, the photons in a light wave, this wave itself shows where you expect many photons and where you can expect few photons. Where the wave is highly oscillating, there are many photons, and when the wave is nearly stationary, doing nothing, then there are only few photons. That's roughly what it does. But the people in Copenhagen started to argue, and finally they found complete agreement with each other. Except for one thing, the agreement was not about reality. So what they agreed about was, don't ask the question. Don't ask what it is that really goes on. Just do the calculation, and we know exactly how to write down all equations. So just do your calculations with these equations, and then you'll find statistically how particles behave. And that is all you really want to know, because when you do an experiment, you'll never get better answers than sometimes this, and sometimes that, and sometimes that. When you do an experiment, you count how many ones do I earn with a basket full of eggs, you get sometimes this answer, sometimes that answer, sometimes that answer. So since that is the experimental situation, don't ask what really happens when you sell eggs in terms of gluons. Many physicists were quite happy with that answer because they said, now we can do physics. Now we can go on and do the rest, like finding how these atoms are built up of subatomic particles and so on. How do these subatomic particles obey the laws of quantum mechanics and so on and so forth. This is what we are doing in our next steps. But still, I find that I also agree with all the statements that these people obtained in Copenhagen when they discussed this. Except, they said, don't ask the question about reality. Here, I disobey. I say, no, I agree with all your equations, but I still think there's something, some reality behind it. And the strange thing is that people came with very strange theories indeed about what reality is. Some people said that all possible prices of the eggs are reality. In one universe, you get so many Yangs, Huans, for eggs, another universe this, another universe that. All those universes exist. I find that answer very unsatisfactory. But in any case, you can still get away with that answer, and lots of physicists believe it some way or another. So there are some real aspects of this theory that are very dubious and that are reasons for people to say that there is no reality behind quantum mechanics. One thing is this, you can also discuss a sale, you know, eggs to gluons, that took place 100 years before. And you still have the eggs and you still have your wallet with the gluons. And then later you can decide whether you want to buy other eggs with the remainder, or whether you want to sell all your eggs and get your gluons back. You can still decide that 100 years after you made the sale. And still the theory works. But the theory didn't tell you whether you how many gluons you actually paid or how many eggs you actually got. The theory tells you only after you checked your wallet 100 years later. And then you can do it both ways. This caused a lot of confusion. In fact, Einstein himself, together with other people, was one of the first to point out that there's something about quantum mechanics not quite right at this point. And now I'll address for a moment the physicists in this room, because I think most of them will know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a paradox. Einstein, together with two co-authors, the name of Rosen and Podolsky, they wrote a paper where they tried to work out the reason why quantum mechanics couldn't be right. There's no reality behind quantum mechanics, therefore quantum mechanics is wrong. That was roughly what they were trying to say. And when I talk about gluons, about eggs, so the eggs could be replaced by you measure whether a photon is polarized in this direction or in that direction. I don't know how much experience you have with Polaroid sunglasses. If it takes Polaroid sunglasses, you hold them like this, you see that every sunglass, every of these glasses absorbs about 50% of the light. But when you hold them against each other and you rotate them, you'll find that sometimes they absorb 100% of the light, sometimes the second Polaroid doesn't absorb anymore. So you find that actually light is polarized. And light can be polarized in two directions, this direction or that direction. I claim that if you look whether photons are polarized this way or that way, you are talking about the eggs that you have been using, that you have bought with your Huans. If you talk about the Huans, you talk about light being polarized in the diagonal direction. Now, the photon is one of these particles that can only rotate in distinct ways. So the photon can be rotated this way or that way, but not in between. Or you can say, well, it can also rotate in this position, but then the other position is that one. You understand that, again, this is a confusing way of thinking about photons, and it gives rise to all these difficulties. But there was a fundamental paper written by Einstein, Rosen, and Podolsky, where they address this apparent contradiction. What am I measuring? I can make an atom emit two photons, and I can have two photons being polarized the same way. So either two photons are polarized like this, or they are polarized both like this. But now I say I can also make this measure the polarization in the diagonal direction here, then that photon may either be in the same direction or a different direction, but also in diagonally. So now you can say that the orientation of the photon depends on the orientation of the other photon. And all this gave rise to tremendous Babylonic confusions about how to describe particles in quantum mechanics, the so-called EPR paradox. And of course, I'm discussing about John Bell's way of describing the paradox that Einstein, Rosen, and Podolsky were talking about. So the question remains, can we make what I call all the physicists about this topic talk an ontological theory. Ontological means referring to what's really happening. Ontos is reality in Greek. So we're talking about what is really happening when you do a quantum experiment. And the answer is you have to talk about states. And mathematically, it goes without any problems. A particle can be in a state A or a state B, but it can also be in a superposition. We write that as adding up A with the coefficient lambda, another B with the coefficient mu. And these lambda and mu are numbers, complex numbers. And if you take lambda squared and mu squared, you get the probability that you find A or the probability that you find B. And then, once you know that, you can calculate everything you like. So A and B are really vector-like objects. They can rotate in any direction. But this is a real state. That is a real state. If you rotate, you go into an intermediate cloudy state. But you have two cloudy states, which could be this and this. And now we don't know. Maybe those are real. These two are real, and not these two are real. You understand, you know, how difficult for me it is to even get this message across. Probably many of you haven't understood quite the details of what I'm trying to say here. This is just then to illustrate that quantum mechanics is a confusing theory. And it is amazing that the equations that we use work so tremendously well. They describe everything we know about the subatomic particles. However, there's now a problem. We did not succeed in finding those real states that we are actually describing. It would have been so nice if you would find an underlying theory, a theory where the quanta are always quanta, but never have to be mixed, like I did with the Huans and the eggs. Maybe there's an underlying theory where you can buy things only for integer quanta, for integer Huans and integer eggs, and there never is any dispute about the numbers of eggs not matching with the numbers of Huans. Wouldn't it be nice to say, no, we have actually egg yolk and another kind of currency like bitcoins for Huans, and maybe then it all matches. But we couldn't find that. And in a situation that we failed to solve a problem, because people searched very hard for such an answer, but they couldn't. What people then do is they prove it's impossible. Because look, if you do a scientific investigation and you don't succeed, you want to make sure that nobody succeeds. So you say, I can prove that it doesn't work. And that's what they did. Mathematicians started to prove that there is no reality behind quantum mechanics. And one person who almost succeeded in this was John Bell. I knew Bell at the time. He was at CERN when I was there at CERN as well, and we had discussions, not so much about this, but about physically more tangible problems. But he was always interested in this question. And Bell had proven that there is no real theory. And basically, the proof was that you have a sale 100 years ago, and after 100 years, you check how many Juans or how many eggs you bought, and you can still choose what to count. Do you count eggs or do you count Juans? And once you've decided which of them you count, you know what the sale was in the past. But it sometimes doesn't match. And he wanted to use this to prove that there is no real theory describing what happened. But the point was that what you are measuring now somehow must be related to what happened in the distant past. So you measure now how many eggs you have. Now I want to know what happened 100 years ago when I bought those eggs. The consequence of this is that what you measure now is correlated with, well, in the past, whether the number of eggs was sharp or the number of ones was sharp. Which of these was sharp or not in the past? That's what you want to know. And now Bell says there's a contradiction. And he could practically prove that there's a contradiction. I don't go through all the details of this proof. This is an argument that would be more appropriate for a lecture among physicists. Then I can tell, we can discuss exactly what Bell said, but now I just only give you the flavor of what he was trying to say. And one of the problem is, the question was, the observer 100 years later can choose whether he measures the number of eggs or measures the number of ones. How does that observer choose that? And Bell said, okay, if he makes a choice, then that choice will be correlated with particles in the past. That's impossible. So that must be wrong. But there's one little issue here. How did the observer decide to count the Juans or to count the eggs? How did he do that? If he made a decision, that decision has an effect on the past, on the subatomic particles, of course, if you do the real theory. But how can this effect have traveled back from the future to the past? And Bell said there's causality, the future does not affect the past, therefore this is impossible. And he turned that into a very powerful theorem mathematically. And many people now say Bell proved that quantum mechanics has no real theory behind it. And the reason is that the observer has free will either to measure the Juans or to measure the eggs. Unless you say that the observer does not have that free will. And here comes, finally then, the topic of my talk. Does the observer have the free will to choose whether he should measure Juans or measure the eggs? And again, I'm still hanging on to that metaphor, although you really have to talk about subatomic particles or very tiny particles, photons and so on. The real experiments are done with photons and not with eggs and Juans, of course. But you can understand why I'm using this metaphor, just to try to make it a little more lively. Did that observer who counts have the free will to decide what he would count? My claim is, no, he did not. What he was counting actually depends on also what happened 100 years ago. But that's very strange, because how can he, can anybody have his decision be determined by such a crazy event happening so long ago? How could that possibly be? And Bell then describes this in a paper, and where he says that one has to allow freely operating experimenters. And I had lots of web discussions with colleagues on this topic and asked them, what did Bell mean here? And they said, well, you know, it didn't really mean freely operating experimenters. He really meant that what the experimenter does should not depend on, literally, on what its particles did in the distant past. But this is very important. He derives from that an equation that he uses in his theorem. In his theorem that no reality exists. And from those equations, then he derives that reality doesn't exist. But for that, he needs that the observer has free will to count this or to count that. And we claim, no, the observer does not have that free will. In fact, it's not so that the observer in the future, whether he measures this or measures that, the observer in the future doesn't send this influence back to the past. It's the other way around. What happened in the distant past affected the decision of the observer in the future. But that kind of effect, what can that possibly be? And here is a point where heavy discussions took place. And whenever I come to explain why I think the observer did not have the free choice, but what he chose actually was correlated with what happens in the past, because of a physical signal that was conserved, was propagating, they say that's unscientific. And it's a conspiracy. You can't have those eggs to conspire to make the observer later count the eggs instead of the ones. That you can't expect in a properly functioning theory. I think you can, and one way you have to say this is there's a law of conservation. Conservation laws are very important in nature, and for instance, angular momentum, you know, if you hold a fastly rotating wheel, like of a bicycle, for instance, and you suddenly rotate the wheel around, then it rotates the other way. If you do that, then you start to rotate yourself. That's conservation of angular momentum. And angular momentum is an exact conservation law in physics. There's a similar conservation law in quantum mechanics called the conservation of ontology. Once something was ontological in the past, you had a definite state, it must be ontological in the future as well. If you take such a law seriously, and I think you have to, then this feature that people call unscientific or conspiracy is no longer such a conspiration. It's the same conspiration that says angular momentum is conserved. Not very much of a conspiracy. Anybody can understand that. But even in all physical phenomena, it stays a conservation law. And so also ontology, whether something is really existing or not, is a conserved property of a system. And when you say that, you say, okay, if the number of ones, number of eggs became vague, then it's vague now, it would also be vague in the future. That's the conservation of ontology. So if it is well-defined now, it's well-defined in the future. If in the future an observer decides to measure the eggs, then also the number of eggs was fixed in the far past because ontology is conserved. This is my answer to the problem, but certainly not everybody is agreeing with that. For instance, there was a famous free will theorem, Conway and Cochen, two mathematicians, had a marvelous mathematical theorem. I liked their mathematical theorem a lot, except they said, now we proved that there is free will. But really what they proved is that quantum mechanics has some undecided features in it. And free will was a property that they assumed for the particles, and then it's also in the observers, or the other way around. But anyway, if you assume free will, you get free will. What kind of theorem is that? But they say, okay, this is the same freedom as I have right now. He was interviewing someone on the radio and said, now, I have this cup of coffee. I have the free will to throw it in the room or just drink it. And that's my free will. I'll show it to you now. I don't know how this ended, this discussion. But he said that he had the free will. I only throw this device, etc. But now he had the free will of deciding once at the very moment what he does, and that should not depend on how particles are correlated in the past. But when you think a bit harder about the universe, it's not that easy. In the universe, suppose that the universe is controlled by a completely deterministic theory where everything depends on everything else. Then certainly whatever John Bell is doing or whatever these mathematicians are doing with their coffee depends on where the atoms were sitting in the far past. It may even depend on how the Big Bang took place in the very beginning of the universe. You don't get rid of these features. If you make any change in the early universe, you make a change now. So whether they are right is not obvious at all. But many physicists, and particularly these people, but also many other of my colleagues, still agree with Bell that conspiracy is unscientific, and that and we have free will, and therefore there is no reality behind quantum mechanics. But there are also always some minority like myself who says, no, there is no free will, and there's nothing unscientific about this, but that also means that there will be a reality, real theory behind quantum mechanics. I find that a more satisfactory description of the quantum mechanical theory, that there is some reality behind it, but now it's my burden and my problem to prove this by making a model. And that is a big difficulty now. I can't make that model. So people can still laugh at me and say, you got it wrong, because all theories about quantum mechanics are theories where there's no reality behind it, and we'll have to live with that. So I have to leave you in this uncertainty. I wish I could now prove to you why I'm right and why the others are wrong. It's not quite that simple. There are still different schools, and there are all sorts of intermediate opinions among physicists and mathematicians as well. So I'd like to end here and leave you with this puzzle, whether there's reality, whether there's free will or not. You can still choose. It's your free will. Thank you. Yes, of course. So I'm quite happy to take questions and
¿Alguna pregunta? Sí. Pulse el botón que tiene sobre la mesa.
Well, in English, I'm going to speak in English. I learned about the Bell thing, about past and future, I don't know about that, but about some angles that you were believing that could go in some angles, and then the reality shows you that cannot be that way. This is what I learned about that. But my question is not related about the Bell thing. It's related about unitarity. And I mean, it's another puzzle. I think, because unitarity in quantum is something that that tells you that things are going to go the same way. For example, in a conservation, what you have said of conservation of the superposition and all this, in this other way is the same. I mean, unitarity tells that things are going to remain, but we are not living in a mathematical world. We are living in a real physical world. And then we have noises that could be caused by thermic things, or even with gravity. So, for example, in quantum computers, the quantum states can collapse suddenly, or maybe hypothetically in black holes, those states also can collapse and unitarity might not be remaining. So my question would be on this. What do you think about the conservation, if the conservations of, for example, unitarity and this superposition and all this has to be always like that, or maybe could be some at some stage not a rule. Okay.
May I try to summarize your question? There are many issues in quantum theory. One question is, do we have to modify the equations in order to get a realistic explanation of quantum mechanics in terms of something that really happens? And do we have to violate some sacred quantum principles, such as unitarity and other mathematical features? Or can we use the language of quantum mechanics itself to describe a realistic underlying theory? And my answer to that is, I think it's the theory itself that you have to use. I don't believe you need any modification of quantum mechanics. That's a very important attitude or standpoint or whatever you name it, because other people seek for solutions by modifying the equations. But I don't think that's a good way, because the equations are very, very clear about everything. And also, the equations have been checked in many cases. So you can write an atom, compute how these electrons move, and find that it really is what they do. So there's nothing wrong with the quantum equations. And they are so universal and so fundamental and so beautiful that nobody really wants these equations to be modified. But I think one can formulate what reality means within the quantum equations. That means that you compute probabilities, but if we would have everything under control, which we don't, but if you would have everything under control, the only probability that would come out of the theory would be probability one if something is true, and probability zero if something is wrong. Nothing in between. That would be the ideal theory. You didn't have to modify any of the equations of quantum mechanics, but just say that the outcome of the equations will always be certainties. That is conceivable. I have a way of doing that, but I can't write models that do this in the way that nature does it with the subatomic particles.
Well, sorry, it's not a question of the theory has to remain or to change. What I am thinking is, if quantum computing is a lot of people is going to spend a lot of money in quantum computing because they're going to get some results. But if the unitarity, for example, is something that maybe is going to be lost because of gravitation, because we live in the Earth and have some gravitation, then even if we use cryogenic things for the qubits...
Okay. Let me just interrupt. I think it's possible even to explain how quantum computers work in principle, but there's a very important limitation. If there is a scale where everything happens with realities and with certainties, then it should be possible to reproduce what a quantum computer does in terms of a classical computer. The distinction quantum and classical should disappear in the ultimate equations. That means that there will be a limit to what a quantum computer can do. And here I have a conjecture saying that quantum computers will do miracles because the realistic theory could be at a scale where things are much, much smaller even than the subatomic particles, so that you can do two miracles, but the miracles will have a limit. You will be able to do fantastic calculations, but not as fantastic as some people claim. So there will be limits to what a quantum computer can do. But maybe you should ask, well, if you don't mind, may we have some other people ask questions as well.
See, if you want, you can sit in the table.
Oh, yes.
¿Alguna cuestión más? ¿Alguna pregunta? Sí, al fondo. Tenemos dos, la que está más cercana y luego la posterior. Sí. Pulsa el botón que tiene sobre la mesa.
I have heard about an experiment in which you have three ways of thinking, three sensors for measuring the spin of a particle. Both three are the full circumference. You divide it in three angles. Each one in each equal angle, you place a sensor, And it's stated mathematically the probability of the sensors for measuring one outcome, given that the spin of the particle is determined at the moment of its creation, and another theory determining that outcome if the results are created when you collapse the wave function. So I wanted to know what were the effects on this experiment in which the probability matches the one in which there's no, the result is created when the wave collapses. What were the effects on the theorem that Bell made?
I'm not sure I understood the question, but the idea is, do we have or can we construct a realistic ontological theory such that it reproduces all quantum experiments without any exception? And these quantum experiments give you probabilistic outcomes, not definite outcomes. But this is always easy to explain, even in a realistic theory, because when we set up an experiment, we have no control over the initial state. In fact, we have no control even if things happen to behave chaotically, so that the tiniest possible error in your initial calculations will lead to gigantic big errors in your final prediction. This means in practice that even if two particles collide head on, you never know how they will react because you don't know exactly how the particles will hit each other. That's impossible to foresee, and therefore the outcome will always be a probabilistic outcome where you have some percentage of the particles go this way, another percentage go that way, and that situation will not change. So what I'm searching for is a realistic theory that says, okay, we didn't know where these particles are, but if we would have known exactly what the initial state is, not in terms of particles, but in terms of whatever constitutes the realistic theory, then we should be able to predict exactly what the outcome of the experiment is. In practice, this will not be feasible, so I don't expect any practical change in the realistic theory, but it's a change of principle. Are there fundamental deterministic laws responsible for the behavior of particles, or is it that there's fundamental quantum mechanics going on which you cannot reduce to any certain theory? My belief is, if you work hard enough, we will find the realistic theory, and so that we no longer need to live with the idea that the laws of nature are probabilistic and not deterministic in nature. So that's the fundamental question. And the idea is, the answer to the question, whatever it is, should reproduce the outcome of an experiment, whatever experiment you think of, where up till now, only quantum mechanics gave you the correct answer. We want a realistic theory that gives the same correct answer. Not because we have uncertainties in the laws, but because we have uncertainties in the initial state. All experiments we do with tiny particles involve billions and billions of atoms and molecules all over the place. And in addition to that, there are fluctuations in the vacuum itself, which may be under control as well. So in practice, it's totally hopeless to be able to predict exactly what will happen. So no surprise that our predictions for any experiment will have a statistical nature. They'll always have that. But there should be deterministic laws that you can hold responsible for this behavior.
Sí, había otra pregunta. Sí.
Hi. Erwin, thanks for the talk. I really enjoyed it. So my question is, in layman's terms, what would be the conservation of ontology explanation for zero-point energy, which you kind of just mentioned, the vacuum fluctuations? Thanks.
But I didn't understand the question now.
what the explanation would be from the point of view of conservation of ontology for zero-point energy or vacuum fluctuations, okay, where particles just appear and then disintegrate?
Well, the question is somewhat hard and ends up being rather technical, but in principle it's simple to explain. In the case of a photon, you can either measure the photon in this direction, whether it oscillates in this direction, or whether it oscillates in this direction. So it can be vertically or horizontally polarized. But if I take a superposition of these two photons, I can get something that looks very much like a photon polarized in the diagonal direction. So the diagonal photon is 50% in the cases it's like this, and 50% in the cases it's like that. Now it's diagonal. Then I can say, okay, that's not ontological. However, if I take this one to be ontological, then there will be another one which is on the other diagonal. So now you have a choice. Are these two the ontological photons, or are these two the ontological photons? Now you see the subtlety, whether they are horizontally or vertically polarized, or whether they are diagonally polarized. And we don't know which is which. We don't know which are ontological, which are reality, and which of them are superpositions. It works both ways. And that's the miracle about quantum mechanics that we know today. No matter which one thing of these things is ontological, the theory works. But now, the idea is there should be an ontological law explaining this behavior. So that law should tell you, is this the real photon, or is that the real photon? Which of these possibilities is it? And the realistic theory should answer that question. But the ontological conservation law is now the following. If you assume this to be the ontological photon, then whatever this photon does in the future will also be ontological. If this one is, the same thing. But if it's diagonal, then all the consequences are different. And now this is the ontological state. And now from that moment on, the underlying theory will give you totally different things that are happening, including the final choice of the observer to measure this or to measure that will depend on whether the original photon was horizontally or vertically or diagonally polarized. So this is a technical answer. If that is not sufficient, then we have to continue discussing in private what it means.
Hello. I like very much your talk, but you know, we are physicists, and so there is one question. You are saying that your theory, your ontological theory, gives the same results exactly as quantum mechanics, basically. There is no way to distinguish it from quantum mechanics? I mean, you know, we could like something like the Bell theorem or something like that to prove either the quantum mechanical probabilistic point of view or some realistic theory like yours.
Oh, okay, the statement I made about believing a realistic underlying theory cannot be checked directly by experiments for the very same reason as the people in Copenhagen said that you can't do an experiment to distinguish a realistic theory from any other quantum theory. So I have no experimental predictions. But it does give you the prediction that we should be able to use such a theory to pin down how subatomic particles may behave or not. Today we have the standard model of the subatomic particles, but that standard model has more than 20 freely adjustable parameters in it, which we don't know how to compute. Now, it is conceivable that once you understand what is really going on, we can say, oh, but now we know where the standard model came from, and now we can compute those numbers. Then the theoretical prediction will be, maybe in the future, if we are lucky, this will happen, and then the realistic model will vindicate. But before that, it's just all a matter of conjecture, and whether or not I can predict that I will convince all my colleagues and peers to believe in this theory or not, I don't know how to predict that one.
So thank you very much for the conference. You mentioned that you have done, or maybe you or others, have done some work on devising some of these ontological models and that they were not totally successful. So my question is, what are the problems, if you can outline them, those models have, and do we learn something from those problems about the, I don't know, the structure of quantum mechanics? Or?
Well, one of the problems is that photons like this, oriented, polarized like this, or polarized diagonally like this, they behave exactly the same way in ordinary quantum mechanics. In terms of a realistic theory, that's very strange, because they're totally different things now. And yet they behave the same way, as if the photon can be rotated continuously. And in fact, we all use that in particle physics, that it looks as if you can rotate the particle continuously. But that's a very difficult feature now of our model. So, so this is one of the difficulties to understand that. But there's one simple example where I could press this idea all the way, and that is if I take a very simplified model of nature, where I only have neutrinos that carry no mass and that would have no interactions. That's not our real world, or admit it, but that world is so simple that I can write down the realistic degrees of freedom for that particular theory, and I can explain to people exactly what transformation to make and what a realistic state is and what probabilistic states are. And now that theory gives you the same behavior of these neutrinos, but they aren't neutrinos. They are sheets of moving material, which are not like particles. But those sheets behave exactly in such a way that an observer may say, I'm looking at neutrinos, and those neutrinos don't have any mass, and they don't interact, so they're rather boring things. This is a very boring universe I'm living in. But now I understand this universe has a realistic underlying picture, and yet it behaves, it obeys the same quantum mechanical laws as in real quantum mechanics. But I didn't get any further than that, so I'm still consider myself not successful at that point. I cannot make better models than that. But I don't see why it should be impossible. It's just quite technical and complicated, but not impossible. Whereas people like Bell would tell me, don't even try, you will never succeed. Well, I don't know.
Sí, tenemos una pregunta, dos, y alguna cuestión más. Dejamos paso a las dos preguntas. Primero aquí, sí.
My question is, could this ontology that you are claiming, could it be rephrased as some sort of non-local hidden variables?
Because of Bell's theorem, the conclusion of many people was, you can still make a hidden variable theory, but it has to be non-local. Mm-hmm. But in my way of seeing things, I don't see what non-locality has to do with it. So I still believe that also hidden variables could indeed have local properties. That's even more dubious, and here someone might be able to prove me wrong, because this is an extra addition where I say I don't see the non-locality now as clearly as some people did. For instance, Bell said, if the world is entirely non-local, you can still have an underlying deterministic theory, but it is pretty horrible, because what happens here immediately affects what happens there, 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 and everywhere in the universe. But that would be a very difficult theory to believe. So again, that's not the kind of theory I want. I want a local theory as well. So I'm not going to give up non-locality. No, I give up locality, but it is now getting very hard.
Sí, damos paso a...
Okay, sorry. So according to quantum mechanics, we are doomed to whether not having free will or not living in a defined state of reality, right? That could be our two choices.
Well, you can have two views of quantum mechanics. One will be that you have a free will to observe whatever you like, and that free will does not depend on what happened in your distant past. Definitely not on what those particles did in the distant past, when before you looked at them. then quantum mechanics is as far as you can get. Quantum mechanics is a beautiful theory. There's nothing wrong with it, mathematically speaking. So then you say yes, but there's no underlying realistic theory. If you say yes, but I can't have free will, I don't have the free will to measure this or measure that, then the subject becomes much more questionable, and then I claim there can still be a realistic theory underlying quantum mechanics. So that's the two possibilities that I say, well, I believe in one, not in the other, but if you believe in the other one, which is a majority, I must say today, then I say, fine, that's your way of dealing with it, but I think I want more of a theory which I find physically realistic.
Bueno, dejamos aquí la conferencia. Aprovecho para agradecer al Instituto de Física Corpuscular su colaboración. Sin ellos no habría sido posible esta conferencia. Al Dr. Taff, la magnífica conferencia que nos ha impartido, y a todos ustedes por acompañarnos esta tarde. Les pido un fuerte aplauso. Muchas gracias.